Now we'll move to our discussion on the implementation and timeline for the Common Core State Standards. Superintendent Smith, would you like to go ahead and introduce this item?
Yes, and we have a whole team of people who are here to do a presentation on Common Core. So we have Sue Ann Higgens, who's our Chief Academic Officer, Melissa Goff, who's the Executive Director of Teaching and Learning, Kimberly Mater, Director of Curriculum and Instruction, Erin Barnett, who is our Senior Communications Manager, and Joe Suggs, the Director of Research Evaluation and Assessment. And I'm not sure where the other team members are, but we'll get started with, I'll introduce you, Sue Ann.
Good evening, Board of Directors and Superintendent and Student Representative. Tonight, I'm here to talk with you about an opportunity our state is engaged in to eliminate disparities of equity to accessing rigorous curriculum. So this is the third year that we've reported to the board on the implementation of the Common Core State Standards. And it may be simplest to frame these around a set of skills we want to make certain that all students have as a minimum set of habits of mind and abilities for them to navigate not just through school to a high school diploma, but beyond. And so it's a single set of performance standards for students. And while it may support the shape curriculum takes, it's not shaped as a curriculum. It's a set of standards that advance in complexity over time so that students complete high school able to do a set of complex tasks around critical thinking and applying prior knowledge, understanding perspective, etc. These standards have so far been adopted by, I think, currently 44 states. And one of the opportunities they present also is to eliminate the challenges given the high levels of mobility experienced by a number of students and their families moving across state lines or from district to district. And so with that, I think it may be simplest for us to look at a three-minute video. This was prepared by the Council of Great City Schools, so a collection of urban school districts are member districts, and this is one snapshot of how to think of the Common Core State Standards. So,
like it or not, life is full of measuring sticks. How smart we are, how fast we are, how well we can, you know, compete. But up until now, it's been pretty hard to tell how well kids are competing in school and how well they're going to do when they get out of school. We like to think that our education system does that, but when it comes to learning what they really need to be successful after graduation, is a girl in your neighborhood being taught as much as her friend over in the next one? Is a graduating senior in, say, St. Louis as prepared to get a job as the graduate in Shanghai? Well, it turns out the answer to both of these questions is no. Because for years, states have been setting different standards for what students should know and be able to do at each grade level. That's making it too hard to know if our kids are really doing well enough overall, and if they can really compete for a job someday. What we really need are clear goals. That's where the Common Core State Standards come in. They're like a total sea change in education. Consistent, strong, clear benchmarks for English language arts and math. Here's how it works. You can think of kindergarten through 12th grade like a giant staircase. Each step is a skill your child needs to learn before stepping up to the next one. But right now, too many kids aren't really confident with, like, 2 plus 2 before they have to move on to 2 times 2. We need more focus on the skills that help them move up the stairs, or they can slip up and fall behind. And there's another problem. What if everyone's stairs were made at different heights? Well, here we go again. They are. So, a boy in Seattle who's rocking an A in English literature could be getting a C on his Chicago friend's staircase. Oops. We need to create consistent steps in education, too. So first, each standard creates a landing on the staircase, a stop along the way as your child heads toward high school graduation. Each stop is a chance for every parent and teacher to focus on the skills their students are supposed to know at that step, no matter the zip code, language, or race. And more importantly, each standard makes sure all students are learning what they need to know to get to graduation and beyond. Because something like counting to 100 leads to understanding dollars and cents, which eventually leads to understanding how to manage a budget. Secondly, the standards are consistent from school to school, and they match up against international standards too. Now we know how we're doing compared to just about everyone. So even though local communities will still design their own curriculum, with the same rules, everybody can compete on the same kind of staircase. But standards aren't learning. That's why we need teachers, parents, and students to help make that happen by working together to help kids meet these standards. The world's getting more and more competitive every day. But now, when our kids get to the top of their staircase, they can have way more options on where their life goes from there. Clear goals, confident, well-prepared students. That's the Common Core State Standards.
At this time, I'd like to ask Melissa Goff, who's our Executive Director of Teaching and Learning, to continue.
Thank you for having us. I did also want to share that our two members who are not sitting here yet are, as you pointed out, expecting a 7 o'clock start time, so they may have gone to grab a bite to eat prior, but we shall carry on. So I thought for the work session tonight it would be important for you to have information just as common background knowledge. In your board packet, you received a lot of information that you may or may not have read. This should give you an overview summary of that. So in the state of Oregon, in the last several years, we have adopted new standards in four different content areas. So those areas are English language arts, English language development, serving our emerging bilingual students, mathematics, and science. In English language arts and math, we have adopted the Common Core State Standards, as Chief Academic Officer Higgens said, and those will be assessed by the Smarter Balanced Assessment, so I'll go into that in a little bit. In the state of Oregon this year, we also adopted new English language development proficiency standards, and we adopted the Next Generation Science Standards. So what are the Common Core? They are a single set of clear student performance standards for English language arts and mathematics. They're aimed at preparing students to succeed in college and the workforce. They are reaching to ensure that every child, regardless of race, ethnicity, or zip code, is held to the same high standards and learns the same skills and information as you saw in that video. And they are currently providing educators with a focused roadmap on what to teach and when. One of the questions that I often hear discussed at school board meetings and in other areas is, what about curriculum? What is the tie between the Common Core State Standards and curriculum? So we will still be using Portland Public Schools selected curriculum. An example of that is we recently had an adoption in elementary school of Bridges. So we use the Bridges curriculum in order to teach to the standards. Another question I hear, so I'm a middle and high school English teacher. That's where my career started and where I am at heart. So do secondary English teachers still get to teach novels? They do. So the question here was, do they need to stop? No. The emphasis in the new standards increases student engagement in nonfiction texts, and oftentimes we will hear people express concerns, and teachers express concerns, and rightly so, that they may no longer be able to engage students in some rich literature that has been historically an access point, particularly at middle and high school. Actually, the increase in the nonfiction literacy standards, you can see the expectation for nonfiction text show up particularly in areas of science and social studies. So in the past, we haven't had literacy standards in social studies or in science in those content areas, but now those teachers are expected to be paying attention to continuing to develop student literacy within their content area. So that's an area of support for us with our teachers. I thought it would be helpful to see what actually looks different in the Common Core. So I happened to pick a standard here that moved in the opposite direction as some of the standards that they were discussing earlier. So how we engage students with the curriculum to address these standards is what changes. So right now we currently have the Common Core State Standards, and we've had them in Oregon for several years now, so that we're not currently adopting those. But formerly, the fourth grade standard for mathematics included extend the base 10 system to read, write, and represent decimal numbers to the hundredths between 0 and 1, between 1 and 2, etc. So it might look like this for a student. They might say, I can read and write these numbers in order from smallest to biggest. And that may have been a question that they received on the test. And so you can see above, kind of the jumbled numbers, and below, smallest to biggest. So what looks different? Well, now what used to be set in fourth grade is now set as a fifth grade standard in the ODE adopted Common Core. And that rigor is also quite different. So recognize that in a multi-digit number, a digit in one place represents 10 times as much as it represents in the place to its right, and 1/10 of what it represents in the place to its left. So you can see those equal signs. It's about do students understand the ratio concepts? And so an example now within that classroom may look like this. If 1.5 blocks stack to 1.5 inches high, then 10 of these little blocks will also equal 1.5 inches because each of my little blocks is only 0.15 inches high. And students would be using manipulatives to show this. So what is different about the Common Core? Well, in English language arts, like I said already, there's a greater emphasis on nonfiction and also a greater emphasis on careful reading of texts. And you'll see that actually through our own teachers working with our own students in a video near the end here. There's also an expectation that students are citing evidence both with their reading and their writing, and that there is close attention paid to academic vocabulary. In math, students are learning about fewer concepts. You saw in that video where between the stairways there were plateau lands. Our expectation is that we're not having to spiral through curriculum as frequently as we have in the past, but we're really teaching students to mastery so that they're able to hit each landing feeling confident. In addition, students are also engaging in mathematical thinking practices. So how do they apply math? How do they think different? How do they justify? How do they show, can they generalize the solution across multiple different scenarios, or can they only use that algorithm in one certain situation? And then also, how do you use real-world examples so that students can better understand concepts? As was said earlier, we've been working with the Common Core for a while and providing professional development to teachers. So in 11-12, we worked with teachers of eighth grade, of our eighth grade students, in providing them professional development. And you can see the trajectory over time. Where we currently sit is in that 2013-14. The star, I guess, would move a little bit closer to the end of the year at this point. And professional development is much more site-based. One of the things that we heard through Dick Tracy's audit last year was that we really wanted to be providing professional development to teachers on site and beyond the school day so that there was not a disruption to student learning in order for teachers to get the professional development they need. So we revamped our professional development model this year and have really attempted for all of our Common Core related training to be site-based. And those are in those Mondays or Tuesday afternoons that we have. And next year, the Common Core State Standard assessments begin, which are called the Smarter Balanced Assessments. And a term you've heard is SBAC, likely. It's no longer referred to that. The K stands for Consortium. So those begin in spring of 2015. That's different than how we currently assess. So right now, although OAKS, the Oregon Assessment of Knowledge and Skills, is designed to be a summative test after all learning has been completed, we actually have a pretty big window during which students are taking their assessments. So between January and June, students in PPS or across the state of Oregon may be taking those assessments. Smarter Balance really looks into late spring to begin and has a much shorter timeline, allowing for more learning to happen and less focus on the test. What we were seeing when I first began 4 years ago here in PPS is some pretty unsound assessment practices to some of the comments that were made earlier from parents. I think it's a very real concern that we don't want to be over-assessing our students. At the time that I started here, we had a pretty common practice, and this was common not just in PPS, but a pretty common practice to use the state end-of-year assessments to try and have that inform a teacher's instruction with the student during right there, right then. The tests aren't designed for that. They're really designed to be given at the very end of the year's learning, and to give us a good barometer as a district, as a whole grade level, how are our students doing? How are we doing with supporting our teachers to support our students? They're not really designed to get down to an incremental skill for a student and inform what you as a teacher can do with that student. So we stopped testing 3 times a year, which was the practice at that time, and we have since gone down to a target of testing once a year if possible and giving a second opportunity if students don't meet the standard. Smarter Balance will be aligned with Common Core State Standards, which again are the Oregon adopted standards at this point. Each time you answer a question correctly, the test will give you a more difficult question to answer. That's called computer adaptive. Similarly, each time you answer a question wrong, it may give you a similar question to see if you're able to answer a similar question and get that one correct. If you still get it wrong, then it will probably give you a simpler question. The current test that we take in Oregon also is computer adaptive, but the design for Smarter Balance is to go beyond the grade band. So the design is for our students who need to be challenged a little bit more in their learning, that they're able to go above outside the grade level. Our OAKS test that we take right now only tests the standards within fourth grade. For example, if you're a fourth grader, you don't get exposed to fifth grade. The other thing that's unique about Smarter Balance is it's beyond a single multiple choice format. So right now, when kids take their knowledge and skills tests, they are given A, B, C, D, sometimes E, and they need to select one of those answers. And I already talked about the test window. So here is an example of an OAKS math sample item. So took this off the internet this afternoon. So based on the graph, which of the following must be true? A, the rabbit and the dog are running in opposite directions. B, the rabbit is running faster than the dog. C, the dog is running faster than the rabbit. D, at the current rate, the dog will catch the rabbit. So none of us have to solve that problem today, but if we did need to solve it, we would need to choose only one of those answers as correct. Here's what a Smarter Balanced assessment item looks like. Again, also at the eighth grade. 6 friends are going to buy pizza. Their choices are to buy 2 medium 10-inch diameter pizzas for $7 each, or 1 large 14-inch diameter pizza for $15. I can tell you this is a real world example from my own home, but I did find it online. Both prices include tax and tip. The friends agree that their best choice is the one that gives them the most pizza for their money. So the question that's presented to students is, what's the best choice? Explain how you got there. So if you note, the former question, the best choice would have been listed in A, B, C, or D. Students would have been given the best choice among lesser choices. Here, the students aren't given a choice at all, and they really need to be able to explain their thinking and explain their answer, and that is very different for students to engage in an assessment that way. And again, I guess I would go back to say, this is actually pretty normal within a learning classroom. So this is the way students are assessed by their classroom teachers. Teachers want to know what kids know and are able to do and how they can explain their thinking. And so the best formative assessments by teachers have these types of questions in them. So another set of standards that were recently adopted are the English Language Proficiency Standards. They were adopted in October of this last school year. And they, again, are updated standards that correspond to more rigorous college and career-ready standards. They will be assessed in 2016-17, so in a couple more years. I thought it would be important for you to know who developed these standards. And they did this with the Council of Chief State School Officers and in collaboration with Stanford's Understanding Language. And Oregon educators, similar to with the Common Core, were participated in review and feedback. So how will the English Language Proficiency Standards be assessed? Well, by a new tool called ELPA 21. It's a consortium of 11 states that's been developing this assessment, similar to the Smarter Balanced assessment. Educator participation in the development has been very critical. And through the end of March, the State Department of Education has been soliciting membership from Oregon teachers to develop items in order to inform this new assessment for our emerging bilingual students. So finally, we also have the next generation science standards. So if there's any theme to what I'm saying, it's that standards are changing. They evolve and change in cyclical time frames. So there are four sets of standards that are changing during this time frame. Next gen science standards is another example of standards that have gone across multiple states. So looking at how interconnected the natural world is with the real world that we experience. Again, performance expectations, similar to what we talked about before, there's no prescribed curriculum with the next generation science standards. Concepts are built K through 12, similar to our other standards. Also similarly, a real look at, do students understand the deep conceptual content? Something unique is that science and engineering are embedded in next-gen science standards, which has been a criticism that our current standards have not had. So students have entered into late high school before they've had opportunities in engineering, and this creates opportunities for students at a much earlier age. Again, the theme of college, career, and citizenship continues. And next-generation science standards are aligned to the Common Core state standards. These standards are our most recently adopted standards. They were adopted just last month. They'll be phased in over the next several years and will be assessed in spring of 2019. All right, now I'm going to hand over to Erin Barnett from Communications.
Thank you, Superintendent Smith, directors. So, obviously, one of the most important things that we can do as communicators and as a school district is to help our parents understand what can sometimes be complex concepts or appear to be complex initially. And the goal of the communications that we are trying to do really on every topic, but particularly the Common Core and the Smarter Balanced Assessment, is just to help families understand what their children are learning so that they can support their children's learning. And support their ability to prepare for college and career. I always take the opportunity to repeat again, Common Core standards, it's a set of shared expectations about what students need to know at each grade level in math and language arts at this point. So an example is just being able to ask and answer questions to demonstrate an understanding of a text, but referring to the text as the basis for those answers. So that's one of those examples. My son's in third grade, you're about to meet him on the screen in a second. And so this is close to my heart. Smarter balanced assessments then are the assessments of the Common Core state standards to measure the mastery of the content and the critical thinking skills so that we have an alignment that makes sense for teachers and for families to understand how students are doing. And an example, Melissa gave some great ones, just where you might, for instance, just read a short passage and then type in your answers to the questions and using details from the text to support your answers. You'll see a little more on that in the video. Another important thing that we do is help people understand what things are and what things are not. One of the outstanding websites that's done a great job of helping families understand what Common Core state standards are not is the National Education Association. This is they have an amazing overview and toolbox for parents, and they include a list of myths and try to help folks understand. And I just took a couple of those key ones out that again, the standards are created by states, so they're not a federal mandate. They do describe the competencies that students need to compete in a global economy, not what teachers should teach or how students should learn. And local teachers, principals, superintendents, and others decide how the standards are met, providing for that local relevance and discretion that we all want. So this is me and my son, Cole. He's in third grade at Riki. And where I understood what the Common Core state standards are and what my goal as a communicator is when he went to solve a somewhat complicated subtraction problem. And in my mind, I'm like, okay, you write the two things down, and then you do this, and you carry that, and you come up, and I have this very linear approach. And he immediately draws a number line and very quickly comes to the right answer by drawing this picture of this number line and doing these little quick calculations. And he said, see, Mommy, I just do a number line. There's a few strategies you can use, but this is the one that I like. And I'm like, wow, that is so different. But I got that he was being taught a number of different ways to solve a problem, and that felt very real world to me, and it's reassuring to me as a mom. So information for families we've already provided. We have already started, obviously, communicating about this back in the spring of 2012. You do have examples in your packets of some of the materials that we've already prepared. We worked with our colleagues in curriculum and instruction to create a website. We've done some family advisories. This is one of our opportunities where we're able to communicate things in all of our supported languages. We've also done some Q&As. We did a PowerPoint for back-to-school nights in the last fall. This spring, we've started with some newsletters. We will also be doing some additional family advisories and other pieces that are allowing us to communicate in all of our languages. I also want to note that there are many outstanding websites and organizations that are also helping with communications, from the Oregon Department of Education, Council for Great City Schools, National Education Association, American Federation of Teachers. PTA has done a lot of great stuff. So parents are getting a lot of great information, a lot of it translated also into Spanish. So that's been really excellent. Some of the things that we are planning to do is, for example, an interactive Q&A. We're starting tonight, for the audience listening at home, we are soliciting questions, and we will start building an FAQ, as you would say, frequently asked questions, to provide answers via Facebook and also on our website. Doing more with that social media to try to answer questions in real time. We are working on a really exciting partnership with Univision to allow us to do some Spanish language outreach on many topics, including this one. We're very excited about that. We're planning parent outreach events, our colleagues in curriculum and assessment, for next year, so that we can do some, you know, hands-on, take it to where people are, answer their questions, and also do more with video. So here's our ask for people who have questions. You can send them to pubinfo@pps.net, and we will start building that FAQ. And now I'm really excited to share with you, we have a video that we've just completed. I believe that one of the teachers, Gracia Merrill from Capitol Hill, and Pam Wilson, the principal, are in the audience tonight. This was a really wonderful collaborative effort between our teachers and Terry Proctor, myself, and others in my department. So we're excited to show you this example to help you envision a little bit more about the Common Core in our schools. Here it is.
And A2 tells us, what are the dimensions, or it asks us, what are the dimensions of the juice box if we want this volume? The lesson today was on volume and surface area, something we've been working on for a while. And they were specifically comparing volumes of two different 3D figures, so cylinders and rectangular prisms, looking at the surface areas and comparing if two things have the same volume, do they also have the same surface area? Okay, so right now this is the way their company is canning, putting, they don't have boxes, they have juice cans. So they're little juice cans. So one of the things in Common Core that's really important is students have to know the formulas more than in the past. So I really try to make sure that they understand not just the content, like here's how you use the formula, but what's the process behind it. So what do we need to figure out about those?
The height or the...
The area of each one, are they both the same? One of the biggest things we see in Common Core is the shift of content. Things that used to be eighth or even high school are now sitting in the seventh grade year. We have a top and a bottom. How big are these ends? They struggle with, how do I draw it? How do I model it? How do I build it? So it's helping instill in them, so, oh, this is what the length and the width and the height really mean, and this is how it all fits together. another big shift with the Common Core is we not just have the content standards, we also have process standards. And the process standards are things that we should see, it's kind of more the how, like what we should see kids doing in classrooms. See if you guys can calculate the surface area of this. Do you remember how we did that? The process standards are really important to how they're learning the math, of them showing what they're doing. Another piece that I think is important with the Common Core is students have to be able to learn to work together, and it's not, I don't find that it's always natural for them to know how to work together. With Common Core, I'm seeing more and more.
Times 2.99.
That I can decide who should be what. So I need you to have really clear. I need you to stay.
With each other.
Together. The goal for today's class was to do a reread of the Bremerton musical, and today students focused on story structure and looking for patterns within the story.
Okay, so what is the change?
It expands so much.
By actually taking a really close look at the text first and really thinking about it, then doing a peer share to share ideas with peers next to them, then having them share aloud so they could hear answers.
It said people will love me, but then there was two.
The rereading helps them build meaning and understanding behind what they're reading. To give voices behind the characters really gives it life for them. Before, how we taught reading, we asked students to make a lot of personal connections and to form opinions, basically, on the reading. Close reading and the Common Core State Standards have really changed our focus for us teachers to really get our students to find evidence to support their answers instead, and to reread and really become better readers because they can understand it better with those rereadings. It really levels the playing ground for all students. I really feel like the close reading lesson plans teach really important skills to students that I believe will transfer on, and because I want them to be able to pick up any other text. Remember, I need to reread this so that I can understand it better. And I really feel like the comprehension levels of my students have grown greatly using this evidence-based reading.
I can identify the problem.
You guys did so many things today. I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So at this time, we just are here to engage in the conversation however you would like us to engage. I did notice that the Director of Research Evaluation and Assessment, Joe Suggs, to my left, and the Director of Instruction, Curriculum, and Assessment, Dr. Kimberly Mateer, to my right, have joined us.
Okay, I guess we'll just start with questions from board members. Director Curler?
So Common Core didn't do science?
No.
Why?
They started with language arts and math.
And then they gave up?
I think they decided to see how well they could do two subject areas. I mean, to be honest with you, it's the Common Core doing language arts and mathematics led to us also having the next generation science standards, but the first two subject areas that were developed were in English, language arts, and math.
I think not all states are equally interested in science, shall we say, so there's another issue there too in the national level.
But
luckily not a concern here in Oregon. Just saying. So I had a number of questions more around the assessment side of it. So I'm very supportive, really excited about having higher standards and consistent standards for kids. Really loved, thank you so much for bringing the video, seeing actually in practice in our classrooms with our teachers. That was fabulous. So my questions are around, I'm really concerned and wanting to be sure that the state's implementation is effective and that there aren't unintended consequences. And also just around the whole the funding and support for districts that's coming from the state. So just for me, it'd be really helpful to hear kind of your perspective as you're one of the districts implementing it. How, I mean, there's a number of concerns that I have around, is the state providing sufficient time and resources for professional development, for the transition, for even acquiring the technology and the materials and everything that districts need. So that's kind of one piece, sort of the time and the resources. And then around the piloting of the stormwater balance assessment, you know, what's the time frame for that? How are we, what's the assurance that the state is really going to get it right before it rolls it? I understand that they're in the middle of piloting it right now, but do you have a sense from the state? I just, you know, where are they? And my understanding is that it still has yet to be fully approved.
Why don't we start with one question?
Okay.
And then ask for answers on that.
Okay.
With each, yeah. So give them a chance to answer one and then we'll move to the next. So which one would you like?
Well, let's start with the what you understand about in terms of what the state is providing for resources for professional development and implementation, and including materials and technology.
Great.
So I can start with that, and then I will actually ask my colleagues to speak a little more. How the state primarily supported in the beginning was by establishing the Common Core State Standards Stewardship Team that was representative from across the state. Mostly of district office, central office staff to try and help us begin to create what does this implementation timeline look like for your district and what tools can we share across districts to help us get started. So I served on that team in my former district and continued to serve on that team representing Portland when I joined Portland Public Schools. That was a real asset. Part of your question also, however, was around the professional development support. So only this year are we receiving targeted dollars from the Oregon Department of Education to assist us in this shift to the Common Core. And it's very helpful to have those dollars now. It's very helpful to have those dollars now.
But we haven't had them previously.
But we have not, correct.
And is there any commitment to ongoing? Are you talking about for this? It was committed for this current school year or through the biennium or?
Yeah, so I'm gonna ask Dr. Mateer to speak to that.
Yes, and so it will end, the grant that we currently have will end in June of 2015.
Okay. And how about in terms of the computers or other technology materials, what is the state doing in terms of providing resources to districts? And do you have any sense of where do we have a shortfall there in order to be able to implement the Smarter Balance Assessment and the rest of it?
So two questions.
Yeah, sorry.
So the first is, how has the state resourced us for technology?
Mm-hmm.
And there has been no change in the state resourcing of technology in order to prepare for the Smarter Balanced Assessment. So that has been very difficult for us as a large urban district to, with varying degrees of up-to-date technology implemented across our schools to ensure that we have the technology that will work for our kids. That being said, I just met with our CIO, Josh Klein, today to verify that what I thought to be true is true. We believe we're going to be able to assess our students in the technology that we're planning to purchase to support instruction. So our plan for technology or curriculum purchasing has always been focused on learning and instruction first, and this new purchase that you have in your that you're currently considering as part of your board budget is built the same way. So we believe that if those investments are made in technology, that the technology we will be able to purchase, that students will have access to and teachers will have access to for learning throughout the year, will be sufficient also to meet the needs during the assessment.
I'll go back to mine later.
Director Curler?
Yeah, so just I wanted to follow up on that because I was at a school while they were taking the test. I believe it was the Oaks test, I'm not exactly sure, but it was. And it was in a particular classroom, and the computers got wheeled in, and watching the kids take the test was quite enlightening because probably maybe
say a quarter of the computers weren't working, and then they had to go and get up and get another one. And so it was evident to me that day that at that school that the technology was a huge roadblock. And so are you saying that the investments that are in this budget that we're looking at, would that problem is not going to exist in any schools if we pass that budget?
I think that is a wonderful question, to which I would love to say yes, absolutely. Uh-huh. I actually am going to look over my shoulder to Josh Klein. Yeah.
So there's a lot of outdated technology in the district, and if you compare the average age of our systems in our district to the average age of computers in other Council of Great City Schools districts, ours are older, so we're behind. We haven't made significant investments. It's upsetting to hear that there's computers that aren't working when we need them for instruction or for assessment. We need to make more investments, and I'm really excited about the $1 million in the proposed budget for technology. I think it's a great start in getting us well again. We need to continue to make those investments. I can't tell you there won't be any struggles at all when we take this assessment. What I can tell you is we're gonna learn a lot through the field test that's happening right now around the type of technology that can best be used for instruction and also for the assessment both. And then we'll make the investments that we need to make using that $1 million to make the process go as smoothly as possible. I think we'll know more after the field test about how things will go based on the technology we currently have in the next few months.
Director Buell?
Can all our computers run the programs they need to do for the testing?
Pretty much. The requirements, the technical requirements for the Smarter Balance assessment are actually pretty much the same as the Oaks assessment. It's not a very demanding set of requirements. It's like, you know, Windows, XP, and 128 megs of RAM. I mean, it's not a demanding set. In fact, Smarter Balance will continue to support Windows XP beyond when Microsoft is actually going to support Windows XP. So if a system can be used for Oaks, it can basically be used for Smarter.
Do you know, do we have data that shows whether or not we have an equality across the school district based on the number of computers that we have? For instance, at one school may have one computer lab, say, and so the computers are gone for 3 months, say, in that lab. And in another school, they've got enough computers so that they're only gone for a month. I mean, do we have that kind of data available? I'd love to, if you do, I'd love to see it.
Yeah,
you can send it to me, I'd appreciate it.
It's a really good question. We don't have very good data around that. We're currently trying to get better data around all of our computer labs in each of our schools and how many systems and what type of systems are in each of those labs. And then also how many mobile labs we have in each of our schools that are readily available for use. We'll have some data, I think, in the next few months, and certainly we need to have that data before we make that strategic investment next school year. So I'm not satisfied with the level of data that we currently have, and we're in the process of collecting better data.
Thank you.
Technology questions?
I had a follow-up on the technology. I know it's a little bit of a sidebar, but
go ahead.
If you're doing that, also just knowing where the smart boards and other technology pieces are, because it's just been a continual question. I know that there's sort of spot fundraising for that, and just being able to know that there's, and that other schools have gotten grants and through Title I and other places perhaps have gotten them. So just to be able to know who has what and make sure we have equitable access to technology would be great. Just in terms of the pilot, what is the state's process? And I've tried going on the ODA website, and sometimes I'm not always as successful as I like in finding things there, so maybe. but in terms of the, so they're piloting it right now around the state, the Smarter Balance assessment. And my understanding is the state board is not fully, is not finally approved it. In other words, they're still in this piloting phase. So what is the process going to be so when you find out how well it works, when teachers have comments about it and so forth, is there going to be a report back? Is there a point at which, because my concern is I would love us to give feedback and our feelings as a board to the decision makers at the state level, but I'm not clear on what their process is and how we might be able to weigh in on that. Do you guys know anything about that piece?
I can speak a little bit to that. First of all, in terms of semantics, in the assessment world, pilot and field test mean two different things. And okay. So the pilot test was actually last year.
Okay.
And we did have a handful of schools participate. This year is the field test. The intent of the pilot test is just to make sure that the interface works properly. The field test is designed to make sure that we have reliable and valid test items and then to establish the achievement standards or the cut scores that students will be held accountable to. We will not be receiving any student level, school level, or district level results from the pilot or from the field test.
Mm-hmm.
The state will receive a data file probably late fall or early winter, which they will be able to use to calibrate the performance on the Smarter field test with Oak's performance. And then, of course, the Smarter assessment folks will be using that same set of data across all the 22 states to determine what achievement standards should look like for the mm-hmm. for the state. We do plan to internally hold some focus groups with students after the field tests have completed and hopefully be able to either interview or do some focus groups with a few teachers as well. We haven't fully developed a plan for where we will share that the results or what we learned mm-hmm. from both observing the tests and the data from those focus groups yet, but certainly we want to share it internally so that schools who aren't participating in field tests can get a sense of what the experience was like and know what to expect. And then of course if necessary we can share that in other forums as well.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Director Buell?
Did I understand you correctly to say that we piloted these tests for the state, but we don't get a look at the data school by school? Is that correct?
For the field test, that's correct.
Why would we field test for somebody who wouldn't even let us look at our data? I mean,
because the field test data are used to establish reliability and validity.
Right, but wouldn't we want to see what it looks like ourselves? I mean, wouldn't it have been neat to have that data to look and see and give us a little rundown of this is what's coming? But the state, why sure. why would they make that decision? Do you have
well,
any idea?
Nice
I mean, you're not the
it.
State, I know, but.
Yeah. The reason that I will offer, which I'm sure there are other reasons as well, but I think the primary reason is that because we have never collected the data before, this is the first time, we don't know what sense to make of the data. So that's the purpose of the field test, is to get the data, the results, to look at alignment of the items, to look at alignment of performance against the grade levels that students are in, against the standards that are being assessed, to make sure that the items that students are responding to correctly assess the right standards under the Common Core, and then to establish cut scores, which would then give you the context to be able to make sense of those data.
So once they do that, would they send us back and say, here's where you are on the cut scores? Are they going to do that?
They are not planning to do that with the field test data.
I didn't think
no.
so. Another answer might be, of course, from their perspective, not from yours. I appreciate your perspective. Another reason might be that it kind of offsets the hubbub that is coming. If we looked at them ahead and said, hey, wait a minute, wait a sec, this isn't working out, then they'd have to deal with it earlier and then they really want to. So that's what I would suggest. But thank you for your perspective. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. If I may just add that it is in assessment development, it is standard practice to not release
sure.
Test results for field test items.
Yeah.
Sure.
Director Martin.
I have a few questions, and Melissa, this one, first one is for you. And this is back on one of the comments you made during your presentation. You had talked about the previous Oaks testing be I think three a year and then moving that to one or maybe two a year. And I'm really one of the things I remember a conversation that we had when when folks from the state came down when I first joined the board. And one of the points I brought up at that time and I think continues to be a really important piece, and that is how we're using assessment information data to inform our instruction. I think that is at the core the reason why we do this is to improve outcomes for kids. And so I'm interested in how now we're using assessment information to inform the instruction, and, or are we, and what does that look like?
So, really good question, and thank you for the follow-up.
We currently use summative test data, which is that end of the year test data, to inform the professional development that we provide to schools. So we take a look at, are we seeing strange patterns in fifth grade in mathematics? Is there some area that in particular where we have, with a certain strand like measurement, where a number of fifth graders across our system aren't doing well? What does that tell us? Well, it tells us we probably actually aren't hitting measurement hard enough, and what are we currently using within our measurement lessons? So that's how those assessments are used. We don't currently use them to go down to a teacher's classroom and evaluate from the district level down to a teacher level a student's individual progress.
Okay, so that was the point. And it's more of a summative information
Correct.
That we use to
Correct.
Look at trends versus what I think would be really effective and useful is to have a per student evidence to say, here's the guide for us as, and probably closer to the beginning of the year versus the end of the year. And I don't know if that's something that's a part of what is thought about for the future, but if we're informing before the school year starts
right.
versus
and
after.
Right, and so I have some perspective on that might be a little, that might be important to share. So one is, when we look at summative data, at most when we use it for a student, we use it for one of the three required legs of a stool to determine, okay, what does this tell us about a child? So just taking an Oaks test score does not tell us whether or not a student has mastered or not mastered a certain area. We would want other indicators, and that includes results on the in-program assessments that students are completing, results on teacher-made assessments that teachers are building within their professional learning communities and using as assessments. So I guess the other piece that I would say is it is extremely important that teachers are, that we are giving teachers the respect of their expertise in knowing where students are in their learning. And the best way that we can do that is to provide teachers, as we're trying to do with our professional learning community time to be talking with our colleagues about the formative assessments that they're doing within their classroom and the patterns or individual student results that they're finding that they want to change the outcomes of, and to learn from each other. So so I don't think that it is likely that we will have a state-run assessment system that will well inform the day-to-day instructional moves of a teacher in their classroom with their students. Teachers are going to be doing that using their own developed with their peers formative assessments within the classroom. So we are trying to support both of those things happening. One indicator for us that those things aren't happening is if a singular school or a certain grade level just completely tanks. That makes us wonder, wow, where might we build up that work? But that type of day-to-day look at student gains, that very much is built through a professional learning cadre of teacher-to-teacher conversations.
Okay, if I can have a quick follow-up, because you brought up the teacher's role in this, and one of the things that I'm really interested in hearing about is really the latitude that teachers have both in the Common Core implementation, but also in the assessment. The big concern that I've heard a lot about is the teaching to the test, and I think there was obviously content of the classroom being, it's fair to consider the content of the classroom is also going to be the content of the assessment. I never liked being surprised on a test, but But I'm also really concerned in how the latitude that an individual teacher has in being able to provide their style or brand or flavor of instruction. And the, really, to give you an idea, that the feedback I've had from certain individual teachers, teachers that I respect a great deal, has been fairly critical of the Common Core and concerned with, am I going to be able to teach the way I need to teach and the way I've been successful in teaching because of some of these standards being implemented in my classroom. And that to me is a concern. And I know there isn't a single answer to that, but I'm really curious about, you know, the probably the best word to define it is, what is that latitude? And where do we say certain things are key for a classroom and other things are we need to rely on expertise of the teacher in front of the classroom to make sure those subject matters and those things are being taught. So
Dr. Mateer can answer that. I just want to put in, this is an important time to again call out the difference between standards and curriculum.
Sure.
So we've had standards when I was, we've had standards for a very long time. I remember taking the CTBS test in fifth grade to see if I was on the money with fifth grade standards. So standards themselves are not anything new. Standards are what we are expecting students to learn and be able to do. So when those change, when the standards themselves adapt and change over time, then what happens in the classroom adapts and changes in order for those standards to continue to be met. I think the question that I hear Director Morton is around the flexibility with the curriculum and the flexibility with the instructional strategies I'm using in the classroom. So I'll let Dr. Mateer speak to that.
So I often hear concerns around teacher creativity, but one of the things that I think should be stressed about the Common Core State Standards is that it allows for more creativity and innovation by teachers, because it's the standards, by the very nature of what they're asking students to do, is to think and work collaboratively and to connect to a real world setting. That means that allows teachers to bring in things beyond the classroom setting, so to extend learning beyond the classroom and be able to capture everyday living in their instruction with students. And that's where teachers can really explore and thrive and allow students to get excited and passionate about different topics. So as Erin talked about when she was working with her son in her video, she learned in a very different way. It was very rote, very what we used to call naked numbers in math, where there wasn't context necessarily built around. It was focused more around procedural efficiency. And now, even when I was in the classroom learning, we know your multiplication, know your times table, you just memorize it. Right. And then when I got moved into the classroom and we started moving towards connecting to real world, I remember when we adopted investigations and we started teaching multiplication in a very different way. We would talk about, oh, what if you were working on a farm and you had a cow or a number of cows? We know that cows have four legs. How many? And so you start giving the narrative and start talking about the story behind the math to introduce math to children. So it's very enriching, much more engaging for students in this type of learning that Common Core really sets the tone and context for. And I think that once teachers really dig into these standards, they're going to be able to do a lot more than they ever have been before. That's one thing. The other piece of it, we talk about the importance of collaboration with our students. By having a set of standards across the country that are the same, it is creating collaboration in an amazing way across the country. And I won't say it as eloquently as our former superintendent, Vicki Phillips, but I heard her at a conference one day, and she talked about, she gave this analogy around the Common Core with music. And she talked about how in different communities, there were members creating instruments, and they were making music in their community together. But then as communities started to come together and there were different instruments and different communities and they wanted to play together, they realized that they all were not playing the same notes, and so it didn't sound very good. They agreed to have a standard of how to play particular notes. And then the amazing thing about that is when they played together, they began to make beautiful music and they became more creative and innovative, and now we have all these genres of music. And so having these this set of standards in which now we allow for greater collaboration and collective intelligence to take form will actually create more innovation and creativity in the classroom, which is celebrated in the Common Core State Standards.
Dr. Blatt?
I have a couple of questions. One is, well, there's lots of questions, quite honestly, with Common Core. I mean, this discussion could probably go on for hours and weeks and months. So one question I have is, standards, as you pointed out, Melissa, that come and go, right? They're developed, they're evolving, we're gonna find out these work, they fall short in these areas, they don't do this, they don't do that. My biggest concern, and it started, depends on where you wanna start it, but at some point, people began to use this data as a way to punish or dictate to school districts or teachers or schools and label them and do a whole bunch, which became really damaging. It was the opposite of what I hear assessment being used to figure out what the learning is and then how do we correct to make sure that the students have the best chance possible and have the most options. And we know, or at least I believe, anytime you try something first, you're gonna have lots of bumps and lots of troubles and lots of difficulties, lots of challenges. But that's part of a learning institution, is you try something, you learn from it, you improve it, and you get better. Do we have any sense what the state plans? Because, so for example, when we got a waiver, we moved to focus and priority schools, and the ODE was supposed to be going to less compliance and much more supportive. And I still feel like I'm not sure that transition has been complete, I'll just say that. That it still feels pretty compliance-based. Do we have any sense about where the state is headed with this and or when or if they're going to use this as something to label schools or identify? Like, what is the state's hope with that? And how, I guess I would ask our colleagues, how do we help the state understand what the proper role of assessment would be?
That's a polite way of putting it.
I think I've been fingered for this one.
Director of Research.
Well, the state report cards are, of course, the state's accountability system for schools, and they are based on the summative assessments in large part, and the plan is not to change that, to my knowledge. So SMARTR will replace OAKS in the role that it serves in the formulas for calculating those report card ratings. That's the short answer. Okay. I don't know if you want me to say more about that.
I think that helps, and okay. I think that's a place where we can, where we're going to need to.
I think it's important to weigh in with the state. I mean, we cannot continue to go down the path of the labeling of schools in a negative way that undermines them and goes against everything that we all are trying to do for our students.
Like I said, I'm not opposed to new standards, and right. We can continue to learn, but it seems disingenuous to set a new standard and then come behind it and
with sanctions.
The second question I have comes up from some of the folks who actually piloted it last year at their schools, and it was related. One of you said something about, I think you, Joe, said something about part of the field test is to make sure that what the question's actually asking is testing the skill that we want it to test for. And I've heard a lot of concern about it all being electronic. For example, you pointed out that test where it doesn't give a prompt, it doesn't give an A, B, C, and D, that means a student would probably not handwrite it in, but they would have to type it in. So in fact, the test winds up not testing the content or the knowledge of the student. But, wow, thanks. it really becomes a skill thing, and I don't know if I'm sure we've considered it, but I know some schools have typing in their classrooms that probably wouldn't suffice for this. Some schools don't have typing. How are we planning that, and how are we, is the state even considering this? I mean, again, I know you're not for the state, so I know I'm asking you to answer for the state, but.
Well, I'll take a stab at that. Melissa and her team could address better the instruction of skills like keyboarding, for example, than I can. But it's true that there are a lot of new skills involved in the test. Our hope, and I know Smarter's hope, is that we have some practice and training tests available to help get students oriented to the tools ahead of taking the test. So that they're at least used to the interface, resizing windows, where the buttons are to highlight and so forth. We do have some of that in Oaks currently. The advantage that we have here in Oregon is that the vendor for Smarter is the same vendor that we've been using for Oaks. And to the extent possible, the interface is going to look very similar for our students and for our teachers. So that will be a big help. I do think that there is always the struggle around, are you assessing computer skills or content knowledge? I think that's always going to be there. The test developers are doing their best to minimize that, but it's still going to show up. And I think there's an adjustment period, particularly around cut scores, that's going to need to happen in order to account for that. And typically with a new assessment, you see performance over the first 2 or 3 years make a pretty big increase, and it's not because learning has changed, it's because students are adjusting to the new method of assessment or the new content of the assessments.
I will add to that we are working across departments to help prepare particular guidance for schools around what they should be practicing along the way in terms of giving exposure to the test. So there are practice tests, as Joe mentioned, and then we've outlined particular behaviors or practice skills that students should be participating in. And then I know we've also had the discussion about working with the test coordinators on a more regular basis to check in with schools to see how they're doing around giving practice to students. But I also want to caution around this idea of keyboarding and other skills in terms of interfacing with the computer, because many of our students have a lot of practice with computers and technology more than what we may realize. And the traditional kinds of keyboarding that we've had in the past is not how students of this new digital age navigate keyboards. And they actually have developed their own strategies and ways to navigate the keyboard that are a lot faster and quicker. If you see how quickly students can send text messages now, I mean, they're really, they're pretty amazing. And I had the opportunity to even watch some kindergarten students who were exposed to some computer testing doing a pilot at one of the schools, not around Smart or Balanced, but it was a MAP, primary version of MAP. And they were doing just fine. And so it was new to them, but they quickly were able to adapt and catch on. So I think it won't be as critical as we think, but we definitely want students to be able to have exposure and practice in terms of navigating some of the new features.
Dr. Moore?
I would agree with you. I think hope springs eternal when it comes to that. I think the reality is that there is continuing. In fact, the Portland Tribune yesterday or today, whenever it was, published an article about Google and their fiber lines, and it really talked about the digital divide and how that is actually, in fact, growing, not shrinking. So I think there is something that is of a concern for me, because accessibility to technology is something that is an issue in some communities and remains an issue. And that gets me to another point. And I think this is I don't know how loaded this whole question is or comment is, but I think I want to first say standards, and I appreciate you Melissa, creating the talking about the difference between standards and curriculum. I think that's an important distinction. But and I don't have any challenge to us creating a set of standards, particularly high standards for all kids. I think this is a good thing. What concerns me is creating standards that are high, but that appear as though they create opportunity to elevate expectations for kids that are already achieving, and in some ways leave behind students who are struggling. And a part of that is the you know, whether that's English language learners, or it's children who are on IEPs, or children who frankly just don't have the exposure to education prior to entering kindergarten, don't have summer school before they enter first grade, and so on. We know that there is not just a difference as kids enter kindergarten, but there's also a difference as kids move through the grade. So that's one of the concerns that I have, where let's create standards, but let's make sure that we have the curriculum and the instruction in place that actually allows for an opportunity for all boats to rise in that case, not just those that are already have either the resources or the exposure and relationship with education that then they can achieve even more.
I do want to also caution around that as well, because I think there's a couple of things. I think also the Common Core addresses making sure that our struggling learners have access to rigor too. There have been a lot of research studies out, and even the Council of Great City Schools has more current studies, especially around African American males, where students actually need exposure to rigor in order to accelerate right. learning. And I think the Common Core State Standards, we've been able to, in our professional development materials, really take that message home. It's a focus that we have, and we talk about what are the instructional scaffolds that teachers need to be using to ensure that students have access to rigor. And our message right. has been around acceleration and not remediation. And that, and we're really able to shift that thinking for teachers through the Common Core. And the other piece, I do want to just touch back on the technology, that there's also this presumption that families don't have access to technology. They may not own it, but they have access to it. They share with their friends. There were two schools that I went to see. One was Rosa Parks. That's where the kindergarten students were working mm-hmm. on the computer and were able to do really well. Another school at James John, I was talking with a teacher, and he was telling me about some of his parent engagement strategies. He started a Facebook website, and the engagement went from about 20% to close to 90 or over 90% engagement. The third piece that I want to reference in terms of students not coming into kindergarten with skills, there is a misconception that students of color are coming into kindergarten further behind than their peers, and they're not. They are coming in with skills, but we definitely need to help them maintain that. There is a disconnect, and it's happening once they get to school. So we're working to develop the literacy supports that need to be in place so that we can ensure that all students are growing and learning and have access to rigor.
And there's no question that rigor is important. I think we can look at examples in Portland Public Schools. Franklin High School's Advanced Scholar Program is one of those. I think more I'm concerned about is the delivery of that rigor.
Correct.
The other thing, too, I think what you're referring to with students coming in to kindergarten is more students of color with access to early education, and white children with access to early education are coming in at the same level. What we have, though, at least in our county, is a huge disparity between kids of color's access to early education and also white kids' access to early education. So that's a big difference.
True. Yes. But I just wanted to be clear about, because we've been looking very closely at our KRA data and our literacy data, and our students are coming in with the same average of skills or the expectation around the number of letters that a student should know when they enter into kindergarten, mm-hmm. and it's the same. There is not a huge gap as if it's the way that it's being portrayed. And so I just wanted to be very clear about that.
Thank you.
Student Representative Davidson.
Thank you. So I was going through the FAQ for the Smarter Balanced information. I was looking at specifically the FAQs pertaining to English language learners. And so I was just hoping you could correct me if I'm wrong in my understanding of this. But so it looks like there's text-to-speech only for English, right? But then there is translation in mathematics for Spanish and American Sign Language, but for anything else, you know, there's a bunch of languages listed here, but there's only glossaries for them. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So there's really, you know, for Mandarin, there's not a great support system for those students. They're pretty much left with a glossary and they have to figure out the test.
Yeah, and I think that's really important to point out. It's no better than Oaks is currently in that regard.
Okay. And something that I would just like to point out is that we've been talking a lot about the difference between curriculum and standards, but I mean, as a student, something that, you know, we run across all the time is that the standards become the curriculum, right? You know, it's the standard until someone develops a curriculum. So, I mean, it's just something to think about. So.
Dr. Buell.
I have a 4-page resolution and a 2-page speech, so I'm only going to ask you questions that aren't involved with those things to keep the time down. So I had about 4, and I'll take them one at a time. Well, in the video, you talked about close reading in the second grade, and when I look at 11th grade social studies, we're still doing close reading. Now, that came out of David Coleman, right? And you guys are all familiar, I'm sure, with David Coleman. And a lot of that came out of that information that they did. And that's one of the concerns that I keep talking to high school people about and other people, that close reading has just kind of infiltrated everything. There's some places back east where they're putting Common Core state standards into the PE curriculum, getting close reading in the PE curriculum. And so close reading pushes out a lot of things, and that kind of concerns me. For instance, I had a teacher share with me some of the material that his vice principal had pushed on him on the Common Core. Close reading he was a U.S. history teacher. And so, you know, in my opinion, a class is kind of like a book. If you're teaching United States history and you have 130 hours, we'll say, to teach that, well, you're going to have to leave a lot of stuff out. A lot of things out of U.S. history in order to do 130 hours. Like in a book, if you're limited the number of pages, you're going to have to leave out. I mean, we could write book after book after book just on U.S. history. And if we're asking our history teachers then to do something over and over and over and over and over and over again, which we're asking second graders to do, and we can't figure out how to get from the second grade to the 11th to be able to do that, for me, that doesn't make sense, and I think we should look at that and say, well, maybe that's not the direction to go. You don't have to respond to that. I was just dealing. You're welcome to.
That's okay. You guys have a response. Respond
if you want.
Well,
I don't know if that was really a question, but you have a response.
Well, I think that close reading is a wonderful strategy, yeah, personally, strategy. And I think that what we see in our upper grades, and the reason why we need to support our students in the upper grades with reading strategies and how to attack text, is because we often talk about that students should be ready to learn by third grade. But as students continue in their school career, they're going to come up against increasingly complex texts. And when they do that, it requires a different set of reading skills. And so you still need to practice and you still need to learn how to read as you progress into the older grades. And the other piece of that, there's been a Lexile summary study that has happened over it's a longitudinal study, and it's happened over the course of several decades that shows the Lexile levels in high school are lower than what students will be encountering in the real world. And that is why you see literacy challenges when students exit the school system and are not able to understand the text that they encounter when they're reading their insurance papers, their health forms, and they need to continue to get consultancy around what does this mean. So I think it's important to teach those skills while they're able to practice them with guided support from their teachers, so that they can be more successful once they exit the school system.
But do you have to put them into everything? Do you have to teach that in history? Can't you teach
increased
that someplace else?
Well, that's
in other words, when I was teaching United States history, and I have a master's degree in United States history, I don't remember them using in my classes in college any books that were telling me how to work my television, I don't have a problem with that. In fact, I've advocated that my whole life. The question is, how much is enough? And when I talk to high school teachers, they're saying it's way, way, way too much that we're having now. And in close reading, which is the David Coleman idea, which is what a lot of Common Core is just based around. And as I went through the standards, it was in place after place after place after place after place. And so we're sending out kids who are able to work within a text, but they don't have ideas beyond that text. They can't take that text and put it into a contextual thing. I don't have to put the manual for my refrigerator into a context. I know what I'm doing there. I got the refrigerator in front of me, and I can't figure out how come it keeps leaking water all the time. And so I bring out the manual to look at it. And so that's, but the context is there. But a history, something that someone has spoken in history in some way, it can really only be studied in the context. You have to get to the context. And when I keep talking to teachers, they keep telling me, I can't get to the context because I'm using all this other, it's anywhere near what I should because I'm using all these other close reading. I have to label all these things and da-da-da instead of actually teach the history that they should be teaching.
So part of the goal, I appreciate your perspective as a history teacher and the tight tie to strong purveyors of critical information. That's part of what we're hoping all of our students are able to engage in. So just putting forth the example of a shared experience this school year, we want students to be able to read critically, and we use certain strategies such as close reading in order to develop that throughout the grade levels.
Good strategy.
In order for them to, when they pick up the Oregonian and hear a report around negotiations within Portland Public Schools, for them to understand there is a perspective represented. In order for them to understand when they read the blogs underneath that Oregonian article that there is an alternate perspective represented. In order to understand when they get onto the PPS website or onto the PAT website that there's also perspective to be represented. And most importantly, for them to be able to then, as critical purveyors of information, decide what is their own opinion from all of those different resources of information that are presented. That's what we would hope to be happening in our history classrooms. And if teachers are finding that the strategies that they're using are preventing them from doing that, we would really want to hear that, because of course we do not want that to be blocking clear understanding on the part of students.
Just a second, I think you also had a...
Well, I just wanted to say that there might be a question around supports around professional development, because teachers are making the decision about when to use a strategy, the frequency in which they use the strategy. We provide the strategies for them to use, and they create the design and the delivery. So if they're overusing it, if they're not creating a balance, then that's something that we need to look at, and we can support those teachers in making those kinds of decisions and evaluations. But they have control over that. They don't need to overuse or over-scaffold for a student, because that can actually hinder their growth, and so we want to make sure that they're using it appropriately.
So if we have principals who are going out and saying, I want to see how your lesson plans connect with Common Core strategies, if we have that, then those principals need to be informed that that's not correct, because it's the teacher making the decision on how much they should be using those strategies, which is your words that you just said. Is that correct?
Yes. So let me just be very clear. If a teacher is overusing a strategy to the point that they're not getting through the text, then they need to be evaluating the delivery and the design. Because there are clear structural there are components and structures that allow for balance in the classroom. So that's what I'm saying. We need to examine and look at what's happening. If they're really feeling that way, it's something that needs to be examined.
Which brings me to my next question.
Just a second, Director Buell or Director Belisle.
BB's on both sides.
I know, you just guys are always confusing me.
I just want to say, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, but as I've been researching Common Core since it started, or as long as I've been aware of it, which has been at least 3 or 4 years, I guess when I understood close reading, and I don't know the person you're referring to that apparently started the philosophy or kind of coined the phrase. What I saw is they were, I think it was an example out of New York, where they were taking a text from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. from Birmingham Jail, and they were talking about, and they were going through close reading, and they said, you know, here, let's read it first time through. Okay, here we have this information. Let's do a close reading. And then they began to pull apart some of the terms that he used, and they stopped right there, and they said, no, why would Dr. King use that term? Why did he choose those words? You could have said that 5 different ways. Why did he choose? Which then allowed the teacher to talk about the context, about why, who was Dr. King, why did he choose that words, why was he showing deference here, why was he challenging this, why was he connecting it to a religious higher authority, why did he begin to play those, and so it allowed, so I hear what you're saying about overusing, and do we need to do it in PE, do we need to do it in science, do we need to do it in history, but I guess that's what I took away from that close reading, is that actually it could open up a really large envelope to talk about context.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it could if it's used properly.
Sure.
The problem is that we're not necessarily allowing our teachers to use it properly, because we're asking them to use it so much over and over and over and over again that you don't get to choose where to use it properly and where not, which is what I'm trying to get at here this evening with all the things that I brought forward.
So what
next question?
What the panelist just said was just the opposite of what you're saying. That if somebody is overusing it, then we need to work with them so that they're using other strategies.
But not exactly, because what I'm saying is that the teacher in the classroom should be making that decision.
Sure.
Generally.
Yeah.
So if your principal is coming in and saying, okay, I want you to list those spots where you're using Common Core, the teacher says, no, that'd be overuse. I don't want to do that. I'm all for that. I think that's wonderful. That's exactly where I'm trying to go on a lot of what I'm talking about. So are we saying that that's okay for our teachers to do that? And we can take Gwen Sullivan and she can send out a thing tomorrow to all the teachers in the district that says, if your principal is suggesting you're using Common Core too much, that you can tell your principal no, kind of like the guys at New Seasons, you know, who have a little card that actually says, the supervisor, leave me alone, I know what I'm doing, and they actually give them that card when they're hired, so they can actually do that. So we should send out a card to our teachers that say, to hand to your principal and say, hey, I know what I'm doing, leave me alone, Common Core, I think there's some good things here, but you're overdoing it, which is all I'm really talking about in the end. So that's great. If maybe Gwen can send that out tomorrow, that would be wonderful.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say we need to evaluate to see if that's really happening first.
Right. Exactly.
Yes, it is.
Still got a question?
Steve?
And like I say, I'm only asking questions that aren't in my other material. This morning I looked through the sixth grade test. Now I taught sixth grade for 14 years, so I have a pretty good sense of what sixth grade kids are like, and I worked with them a lot at other times in my career in the 40 years I taught school. And I looked at the sixth grade ODE sample test questions for the reading. And I may need a treadmill test in order to, they were horrible. They were beyond belief horrible. Every one of those six questions, every one, and I'm sure they didn't give out their worst ones, you know what I mean? I mean, they're giving out their best questions. Okay, what's our best questions? We're gonna put these on the website. And they're not doing the worst, and every one of those questions had what I would say was a testing flaw in it. Every one. And some of them, there's a lot of talk about that the rigor is too high. I mean, they did use the word temperance. One of them was Sojourner Truth, and it was talking about where she had worked for temperance. I'm sure we've got a huge percentage of our sixth grade students who will know what temperance is. But there was flaw after flaw in every one. And so I'm concerned about a test that our superintendent of schools can't even look at. She won't be able to see what's on the SBAC test. We're going to be testing across this whole school district, and not one person, and people who are in charge of schooling our children, and the superintendent of schools who's over in charge, and the school board who's elected people in charge of our school system, they can't look at what tests we're giving to 48,000 kids. We can't look at it. And guess what? The ones that they showed us, they're horrible. I mean, I wouldn't give it, they're terrible. They were horrible tests. Are we concerned about that?
Perhaps we can get an answer from the panel. About the testing?
Are we concerned about the weakness of those tests is the question.
Right, so.
In your opinion.
So I think what I heard you say is that the test items that you saw, you didn't feel were well-crafted, that would solicit an accurate evaluation of what a student knows and is able to do. Is that what you saw?
I'm saying they weren't well-crafted. They were horribly crafted.
Right, that they weren't.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they wouldn't solicit an accurate thing. But I also heard you say
that we haven't seen the test. And so my confusion lies in the fact that, as always, we see test sample items, and in order to have a reliable and valid test, you don't actually, just as in any standardized assessment, they don't release the test items exactly the same test items that they're going to be giving to students. So I guess my answer to that would be I don't have a concern, because I do know that that's how reliable and valid test data is used. What I would say I have concerns about are the results not being shared back with us. So you did talk to Joe Suggs about that earlier, and I would share that consternation. I do think if we are asking our students to be assessed, and we are asking our teachers to facilitate students being assessed, that those who are participating in that should be able to take a look and see how things went.
Melissa, what I'm saying is that you've got these six test items that have been released, and we see. These are the sample test items, and they're no good. And yet, we're going to give this test and spend $2 million, I'm sure, on giving a test that the sample test items are rotten.
Well, Steve, I think you keep saying they're rotten and they're no good, but you know,
exactly.
You have to qualify that by saying, in your opinion,
because these are crafted by... Obviously, it's in my
in
opinion.
Your opinion.
I'm not saying
Thank
much
you.
Stuff in somebody else's opinion. But the...
I don't agree with that.
It just seems to me like, have we looked at that? That was my question. You answered and said, well, yeah, we're going to go back that up. But have we gone and said, whoa, these test items aren't very good, and had our testing people look at it and say, our testing people say these items are good, which really would make me question the whole system, of course, but I don't want to get into that.
Okay, so I think you're concerned about the psychometrics of the test, and what I would say is that both at the state level and at local levels, people have been looking at the test items for some time, and that their opinions differ from yours.
The next question I had is, there's an awful lot of teachers that are really upset about the Common Core curriculum and how we're dealing with it in the school. school district, not a little. I mean, I've talked to tons of them, teacher after teacher after teacher after teacher. Matt's even talked to some teachers here, which is who are having things. Yeah, yeah. And have we as a district sat down and said, okay, I want everybody to come forward who's really got problems with this, these tests, and sit down with us and tell us what your problems are so we can look at them and see if we can fix them. Have we done anything like that as a district? Where we've gone out and said, you took Stephen Siegel and you got him at the meeting and said, okay, what is your problem, Stephen? Have we done anything like that, Sue Ann? Melissa always has all my hard questions, so I'll ask Sue Ann.
No, we haven't done anything like that.
Thank you. And my last question then is...
Well, I will say that we haven't done it district-wide, but we've certainly had representatives, teacher representatives, who have looked at items, who have had discussion about the items, who have taken the practice test themselves. Do you guys want to talk about any of the experiences or comment or feedback that you've received from teachers?
We'll have to come down to the microphone so it can be heard by our home audience. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
I'm Marianne Stallnaker. I'm a K-5 literacy TOSA. And last year I was involved in job-alike professional development for our K-3 teachers. And part of that professional development involved introducing them to sample test items on Smarter Balance. Even though the K-2 teachers will not be giving their students those assessments, we wanted them to see the expectations for additional writing and the rigor that was going to be required. And what I can say is that, you know, they were shocked because the rigor is much higher, but they were also very grateful, and they also to be able to see the sample items, and they also felt that they were going to give them really good insights in how to improve their own instruction in terms of asking students to perform at higher levels when they read and write. So I think they felt like by looking at the sample test items, they got really good information about how to improve their instruction and what students were going to be expected to be able to do.
Well, when I looked at the sixth grade test, the thing that caught my eye first, almost after when I went through all six of the questions, I believe there were six, the thing that caught my eye was it wasn't really measuring kids' reading. It was measuring their close reading. Could they pick out this particular passage and so forth? And it reminded me of when I was in teaching the seventh grade, and we were first in the group of language arts teachers in the seventh grade in my school in Covington. We were first in the state of Washington on the testing. We were number one in our economic level. And the way we got to be there is we paid $1,000 a day to a woman to come out and teach us to teach the test. And when I looked at the test questions, the first thing that came into my mind almost was, you better teach to this test better than we taught to the last one, because this is a different test to teach to. And it took me a little while to get the sense of what they were trying to do. The questions were kind of like that old, you know, that old joke when you were like in the second grade and you had that, and kids would ask you the question and say, you know, when the plane crashes in right on the Washington-Oregon border, where do you bury the survivors? and that's what reminded me right away with the questions. You don't bury the survivors. It's a punchline. The point is that was what it reminded me of. It was the gotcha, the little, are you reading close enough to make sure? It wasn't what your reading level is. We know the reading level isn't temperance.
What I can share with you is the response of our teachers from the K-3 job-alikes last year. We met with them once a month.
What does job-alike mean?
Job-alike is the professional development that our department offered to kindergarten through third grade teachers in terms of introducing them to the Common Core and how it relates to the curriculum that we're using. And what I can tell you is that I said earlier that teachers were shocked by the level of rigor, But they were actually, the feedback was very positive. They felt like that students were being asked to do very authentic tasks and to do a lot more critical thinking and writing in response to the reading. So the general response that I got, and I was I did this every month for about 40 teachers, was a very positive win, a kind of a challenge. We can rise to the challenge, but they felt like it was the step in the right direction in terms of the way we test students.
Thank you for sharing that.
Can I just add too, I mean, I was just on my 10-year-old plus computer trying the couple of the sample assessments, and I think I tried the third grade language arts. And I guess to me, you know, as a layperson though, but going through it, to me it was really about, can you understand the passage, and can you write about it, and can you figure out what the author is trying to say and what the meaning of it is? So I didn't see anything to me that was indicative of that you would be A, like specifically trying to, I mean, it was all valid real world skills you need in order to be able to read and understand, whether it's literature or anything else. So, I mean, for what that's worth, right. And I was amazed that it did not crash my ancient computer, so even older, much older than PPS computers.
Director Belisle?
So to get back to your question, Director Buell, about have we ever called everybody together and asked what their opinion is, and I appreciate that we have the TOSA that did Java Likes, because I think that was a good example of what I heard last year is that Java Likes were challenging to get the professional development in the Common Core. And so that feedback was provided, and I imagine that wasn't the only feedback that was provided. And so the district, my understanding is Superintendent Smith and Office of Teaching and Learning, changed their professional development this year to make sure that teachers had it. So, like I said, whether or not it was specific, tell us what you think about Common Core.
They changed it so it was anonymous.
They changed professional development to be more site-based rather than...
I know what I mean. So the feedback is anonymous, and the feedback is...
I think it was given directly to staff.
Yeah, I mean, that's really important.
So last December, December of 2012, we did an anonymous survey of all staff, of all teaching staff around our professional development.
Around Common Core?
We did not provide professional development that was Common Core only.
Right.
We have consistently been focusing on strong instructional practice, and Common Core is a vehicle that we use for that.
And it had open questions. So you could write what you wanted at the end and it was anonymous?
Indeed.
Can you send me those?
Yeah.
I'd really appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Chair. Dr. Kroc, go.
Good. Doctor, you had talked about collaboration being one of the drivers of Common Core. And that was music to my ears. I'm curious to know how we value that in regards to assessments.
Are you talking about classroom assessments, or can you tell me a little bit more?
Yeah, in terms of just the interaction between that value and the Common Core, and how we value that. How's that dealt with? I imagine it's not dealt with in the Smarter Balance assessment, but is it?
Maybe in any one of the three legs of that stool that you mentioned.
Yeah. Well, yes. So Melissa referred to professional learning communities, and that is one of the expectations that we have for our schools, and that we're asking principals to make sure that they provide the structure and time for teachers to be able to engage in collaborative discussions and conversations around their instruction, so their lesson planning and preparation, and also looking at their assessment data around their students, whether it's their embedded formative assessments in the classroom or if they're looking at trends across their grade level team. And so we do encourage that. It's a regular routine part of their work to look at assessment data and see how it might inform any of the instructional decisions that they make. But as Melissa talked about, the summative assessment is not for that purpose.
Okay, so maybe I misunderstood, because I was thinking that when you were talking, that you were talking about the students. So as a collaboration among students as a driver of the Common Core.
So as you saw in the video, all of our students work in cooperative learning groups, and so it gives opportunities for them to share multiple perspectives around information that they are learning and gathering, whether they're doing research, whether they're listening to information that teachers might be introducing to them for the first time. But teachers are expecting students to have engagement with each other so that they're interacting and sharing with each other, that they're building on or elaborating ideas, or if they don't agree, they talk about why they don't agree and that they're giving evidence to support their reasoning and their understanding.
And there's no collaboration component of the Smarter Balanced assessment. That was part of your wondering, how do we assess that? It's not.
Yeah, how do we value it if it's a driver and something we do value?
But it drives the critical thinking, and it gives students that opportunity to practice and sharpen their thinking. Anytime you engage in a conversation with someone, and especially if they have a different perspective than you, it allows you to sharpen your thinking. And so what the Smarter Balanced assessment does try to measure and look at is how students are thinking and grappling with the text, and what evidence do they have to form their thinking around, and how can they cite that and use that to explain their learning and understanding.
Thank you.
Director Atkins.
Okay, so one of the things, just really appreciate your elaborating on this and giving the examples. One thing I was really encouraged to hear, Melissa, in your comments, was just around how this is, the Smarter Balanced assessment is designed and intended to be happen just once toward the end of the year. And I think that's really a move in the right direction. So I appreciate that, and I really appreciate that you have, and Superintendent Smith has led us away from the multiple testing culture. That's very encouraging. I have, though, just kind of been taking notes, and I had put together kind of a draft statement just around some of the concerns that I rushed into right at the beginning, because I have been thinking about them for a while. I know a lot of us have been thinking about this for a while. But just wondering if, you know, the concerns we've heard just in terms of the state's rollout and the implementation, just curious to hear from colleagues if there's interest in putting together, maybe working with staff and putting together a statement to the state expressing the concerns that we're hearing, and then being able to just to share that out. And I would like to do that, and I don't know how many others are seeing nods, so that's great. So I know we're about the end of the time for our study session tonight, but I wondered if the co-chairs could maybe delegate a small group of us to work with staff. I know Director Buell has put together a draft resolution. I've got some draft thoughts put together, and we can sort of, you know, take that and the comments we've heard tonight and the information from staff, and then at a future meeting potentially take action and send it off. And I know the state is doing, you know, it's just really important for us to weigh in. The state is moving right along in their process here, but it really is important for us to weigh in as a district, and I'm hearing a lot of really valid points and concerns as well as support, and I'm really excited about what I'm hearing about the work that you're doing with teachers and the sort of the reality, because again, we are hearing a lot of, there's a lot of varying information out there, let's put it that way. So I'm excited about the positive parts of it. I do have concerns in terms of the state's implementation, so that's what I would really like to weigh in.
I guess I'd say I'd be very interested in that. And I also think that this might be a good opportunity for us, like I think of our technology. Mm-hmm. We know, you stated, we're behind in our technology. We are not going out for capital bonds for technology. It has a short shelf life, unlike some other school districts that are going out for capital bonds. So I'd be really curious as soon as we can get that data, because I do think that it's just rare that I see a fully functioning lab just right. about anywhere, and they are usually reserved right. for testing, and then they're kind of hands off and people kind of scrap together. And I think that's an area that if something good can come out of the challenge of increased assessment or more rigorous assessment, I would hope that we would at least get the benefit of using those tools in everyday learning, as Melissa pointed out, has been our focus.
Anybody else? Okay. Well, thank you all very much. Appreciate you coming and speaking to us. I will say, let me have one comment.
Yeah,
trying to get everybody going here. I'm very appreciative of the work you're doing. I am excited about higher standards for our students. Working in the university setting, I see students come through all the time who clearly have not had the rigor that I would like to see our students have, and make sure that our students, Portland Public School students, are prepared for college and for their careers. So I'm very excited about higher standards. I did have concerns about professional development, whether our teachers are ready for this. You've helped me a little bit with that, but I can see that we still need to work on this to make sure that they're prepared. And and then the other part of it, of course, we've all mentioned, I think, is the technology piece. Very concerned about that and making sure. And for that reason, very supportive of Director Buell and Director Adkins. And maybe we can find one more board member who'd be interested in helping with a small group to try and put together some comments from the district with the help of staff, and bring that back at a later meeting. So thank you again very much for the presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So with that, I guess we'll move ahead to our business agenda.
What about the resolution that I have and that she has? I'd like to read my resolution.
We're not going to do resolutions. We don't do walk-ons. I just said what we were going to do. We're going to have you and Ruth and staff and hopefully another board member get together.
I'm talking about the resolution that I have here that I would like to read and make.
No, we're not doing
that. Why not?
Because we've already passed that part in our agenda.
No, and we just, the resolution, we just had the speed talk, and then as they had the talk, one of the things we talked about all year is that when we have a presentation, you can then make a resolution that as long as it is connected to the presentation, which this is.
No, that's not the process, Steve. And
it's been the process all year.
No, it hasn't. It hasn't. You have your resolution. I think you put a big stack of them up there.
So I'd like to read it. I'd like to read it. We have a television audience. We have it on the record. I'd like to read it. I mean, it's lengthy, but it's only 8:15, and I have a talk, and I'd like to speak to my resolution. I don't understand how you could possibly not allow someone to make a resolution based on it when that was our discussion at the beginning of the year that you can make. I've held this resolution all year.
Not that I know of, but allow me to answer your question,
yeah,
Steve.
Yeah, I'd like to see what kind
of
an answer you have.
If you'd like to make a statement about the Common Core, the time to do that would have been when the people were here. If you'd like to go ahead, will you allow me to finish? Excuse me. If you'd like to go ahead and make a statement, if you wanted to read your resolution
and
as
make
a statement, that's fine, but we are not accepting resolutions here tonight.
Fine. As long as I'm allowed to read it and make the statement based upon it. I have no problem with that. That's all I was asking. Not that you have to vote on it.
Well, that's good. We're not going to vote on it.
Good. Well, of course not. You couldn't deny it anyhow because it changes policy. You'd have to read
it
first. So would this be a first reading?
That's right. No, this is not a first reading.
Okay. Well, I'm,
this is a statement from you about the Common Core, which you can go ahead and make.
When could I make this as a resolution, though?
I think that we just talked about the fact that we're going to have you and Director Adkins and someone else get together and try and form a resolution that a majority of the board will agree to.
But that resolution you said, and I appreciate you allowing me to read this, but that resolution had to do with what we were talking about.
Excuse me, I cannot hear the director here all talking.
That resolution had to do with what we're doing with the state. Are we going to get together and make an overall resolution with the staff on Common Core and how they respond? Because my resolution has to do with how we should be responding to Common Core and what the situation is concerning Common Core. Now, I could ask all these questions to those people, and we'd be here for hours, and I very nicely only asked the four questions that were not in these things.
Right. You can go ahead and bring that up in your group. I think that's just fine.
Okay, so I can read this resolution. Thank you. Here we go. Resolution on Common Core in Portland Public Schools, April 16th, 2014. I'm going to put on my $1. Glasses from the dollar store. I'm now doing promotions, by the way, for people if you're interested, the dollar stores. Whereas the Common Core State Standards were developed and promoted by two private membership organizations, the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers, and by other organizations, none of whom are connected with Portland Public Schools, and these organizations received millions of dollars from private third parties, philanthropies, and corporate interests to advocate for and develop Common Core State Standards for the benefit of corporations, and whereas the corporate profit motives that drive the Common Core state standards are often in direct conflict with good education and can work to the detriment of the children of Portland Public Schools, and whereas the CCSS were developed and vetted by committees of individuals, almost none of whom were K-12 educators, through a process which was not subject to public scrutiny, and whereas in our own state, Common Core state standards were adopted without open and transparent public scrutiny and with minimal input by Oregon educators, and whereas the implementation of Common Core state standards in the Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium testing is a substantial financial burden on Portland Public Schools and Portland's taxpayers, and whereas Common Core state standards have never been piloted, tested, or proven in any arena to increase student learning or prepare students for college, career, or citizenship, and whereas the funds spent to implement Common Core state standards could be better used in well-known effective educational methods such as reducing class size, increasing reading support, adding programs such as the arts or CTE, and alleviating the impacts of poverty on education. And whereas high-stakes testing narrows the curriculum and emphasizes teaching to the test at the expense of other important educational topics and learning experiences, and whereas there are serious questions about the validity of standardized testing to inform instruction, evaluate teachers or other educators, and measure the value of a specific school's educational quality, and whereas data collected under high-stakes testing has been shown to be vulnerable to misuse, and whereas the purpose of education is not solely preparation for college and career, but to educate a populace of critical thinkers who are capable as citizens of shaping a just and equitable society in order to lead good and purpose-filled lives, and whereas the top-down imposition of the Common Core state standards adversely impacts students of highest need, underserved students, emerging by multilingual students, and special education students, and whereas curricular decisions should be in the hands of classroom and district professionals who understand the context and interests of their students, and whereas the Common Core state standards were developed mostly by non-practitioners, implemented too quickly, were not piloted correctly, and may not reflect the learning needs of many of our students, and whereas significant time, effort, and expense associated with modifying our curricula to the Common Core state standards takes precious resources away from meeting the actual needs of our students, and whereas the Portland School Board and its superintendent have a responsibility to make decisions which are in the best interest of students, be it therefore resolved. Portland Public School educators should use the Common Core state standards as only one factor among many in educating Portland Public School students and put no more emphasis on these standards than other important educational factors not listed in the standards, in an effort to make sure Portland Public School students receive a comprehensive and well-rounded education. Be it resolved, district administrators and teachers take into account educational equity in implementing Common Core state standards. This includes, but is not limited to, making sure students in all schools have nearly equal access to the following: a broad range of educational offerings, access to courses outside of tested subjects, which are both considered electives and or part of a traditional education, appropriate testing practices which take into account the background of students, including underserved students, special education students, ESL students, and poverty factors, equal testing support at each school where necessary, field trips, recreational activities, educational projects, and other extracurricular activities, parent communication regarding testing, computer access throughout the year. Be it resolved, money spent directly on Common Core state standards shall be clearly identified in Portland Public School budget documents. Be it resolved, money spent on Common Core state standards and testing shall be carefully reviewed during the budget process by a committee which includes strong representation from parents, the community, and Portland Association of Teachers. This shall include money spent on testing materials, additional staff, additional computer equipment, professional development, and curricular materials. Be it resolved, all data generated by district response to Common Core state standards shall meet a high standard of privacy. Be it resolved, Common Core state standards shall not unnecessarily burden teachers with the following: inordinate amounts of professional development or training to implement the Common Core state standards, both in amount of time spent and in overemphasizing Common Core state standards professional development instead of other forms of professional development or classroom instruction, mandated use of Common Core state standard curricular materials, Common Core state standards used by educators as a part of teacher evaluation or plans of assistance, use of Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium testing as part of teacher evaluations unless specifically mandated by state law, time spent on identifying Common Core state standards use in teachers' lessons, required practice testing for district-wide testing, Be it resolved, Portland Public School Administration shall convene a committee to assess the validity of Common Core state standards and their use within Portland Public Schools. This committee will include strong representation from the PAT as well as PPS parents, students, and community members. This committee shall review and report on the following questions. Are there standards which we believe are incorrect for Portland Public School students? How much of the time spent on teaching to the Common Core state standards could be better spent on other educational endeavors, and what guidelines should be developed? How much instructional time should be dedicated to intervention programs and test preparation classes for students who do not meet the Common Core requirements on the SBAC? Are there standards which are developmentally inappropriate? Are there Common Core standards related decisions which are not helping the education of Portland Public School students? What testing procedures or protocol might create a validity problem for SBAC testing? Is the administration promoting Common Core state standards in a realistic manner, making claims which are backed by peer-reviewed research and experience in other states or locales? What steps should Portland Public Schools take in order to correct any validity problems? What is the effect of high-stakes testing on children, and what can be done to minimize any negative effects? Are restrictions on children brought about by their scores or their school's overall scores on high-stakes testing appropriate, i.e. such as missed electives, missed recess, loss of extracurricular activities? Be it resolved, Portland Public Schools make a concerted effort to inform parents concerning Portland Public use of Common Core state standards as well as their right to opt out of testing. Be it resolved, inordinate pressure to perform on Common Core state standards testing shall not be placed upon students, teachers, or administrators. Be it resolved, pedagogy responding to Common Core state standards shall be based upon well-established educational principles which do not include an overemphasis on scripted curriculum, one type of approach to educational problems such as close reading or nonfiction, wholesale diminishment of literature, developmentally inappropriate instructional practices, inordinate importance placed on testing, or the narrowing of curriculum. Be it resolved, Portland Public Schools shall take a legislative position which opposes state and federal mandates which require Portland Public Schools to use testing to label schools, personnel, or students based on test scores, including the labeling of focus priority schools and subsequent consequences for these schools. Be it resolved, Portland Public Schools shall take a legislative position that the state should suspend the implementation of Common Core for a period of at least 3 years and until this untested mandate has received adequate research and been field tested.
Excuse me. Thank you for sharing that with us,
okay,
Steve.
Okay, now here's the second half you said
me.
I could share.
Thank you for sharing that with us. I see a lot of places where some of the questions that we all had as we were discussing Common Core are included in here. I appreciate that.
Right.
And also,
I'm thinking is that we were not looking at considering that tonight, but that we were going to take everyone's input, what Steve's put together and what I've put together, and then we would come up with something hopefully that we can support.
That's correct. This is not a resolution at this time. This is strictly your thoughts.
Fine.
We appreciate having them. And as I said, I saw a lot of the same kinds of questions that were being raised by other board members, and I can see that there's some places here for where we can all work together and hopefully find something that works for at least four members of the board.
If we're going to go work on this, then I'd like to finish the talk
More?
That goes with this, yes.
Is there something different than what's in here?
It's a statement about what this actually tries to do.
Can we just not?
Why don't I just read it?
Okay, go ahead.
I just want to talk a little about how education works out in the schools and how this relates to Common Core.
In your opinion?
Educators for years have approached new initiatives by going way overboard in their implementation. Common Core is just a set of standards which gets teachers and other educators to think about some specific approaches to education which they might not have thought about a good deal. There's really nothing wrong with this. If that is how it worked, we could all integrate these ideas where they made sense into what we teach and move on. Some of the ideas don't make sense, of course, but there are some good things there. But that is not the approach that educators all across the country have taken, as usual. Common Core is seen by many as the savior of a failing education system, the one approach that can save us. There are several problems with this, as I have outlined in the whereases in my resolution. For one thing, it is a false narrative to say education in general is failing. For another thing, the Common Core itself is no savior. It is a set of standards. Standards don't teach children, Better standards have never been proven to make a real educational difference anywhere, and there is no reason to believe this will be the case here. Given this scenario, it should make us question whether the time, energy, and money we are expending on these standards and the subsequent high-stakes testing make any sense at all. And when you add the way the standards were developed and are being promoted, notably the absence of teachers and the hundreds of millions of dollars siphoned out of our classrooms to line the pockets of some of the richest people on earth, as well as the windfall profits for major corporations, it should make us just a tad bit skeptical. But instead, state after state, district after district, and educator after educator have gone once again overboard in support of something that has tremendous potential to be detrimental to the children of our country, our state, and our city. We have seen it before: SimCam, No Child Left Behind, Whole Language, New Math, Connected Math, Teacher Accountability, and on and on. Instead of balancing our new found information with what we know about educating children, we roll it up into a ball, hardening it with some of the same nonsense of the reform movement, and knock down the pins of sensibility. Think of it this way. Common Core is kind of like pepper. Paul Anthony and I went out to lunch last Monday, and the guy comes around, you know, he comes around, he's got the pepper thing there, and he's turning the pepper to decide if did Paul want on his salad a little pepper. And he said, yeah, and I, do you want a little pepper in my soup? And I said, no, I don't think so. Well, pepper made his better a little bit. And I didn't think it was going to help my soup, but if it had put in, it probably wouldn't have made much difference. But then, does the guy come back when you have your regular meal and say, okay, you want some more pepper, and then just really pepper you into the ground? You want pepper in your water? Do you want pepper on each thing? Do you want, that's kind of what we do with the Common Core. We just have a decently good thing, and we just overemphasize it to the point of ridiculousness. And now a couple comments which are pertinent to information which is bandied about concerning the Common Core state standards. First, they are not state standards. This is a name given them so they won't be seen at first glance as national standards, which are, since it is illegal to have a national curriculum, Which brings us to the next falsehood. Proponents of the Common Core say it is not a curriculum. Well, of course it is. A curriculum is the subjects you study and what you teach. We are asking teachers to teach to the standards. It is a large part of our curriculum. If you are not asking teachers to teach the standards, in effect, teach the standards, then what is your supposedly aligned to the Common Core State Standards Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium test going to test? And why does the Common Core have things like the following in them if it is not a part of your curriculum? Parts of speech, the directive to teach grammar, various math skills, and analytical skills, for instance. Another major obfuscation is the claim that teachers were heavily involved in the development of the Common Core. In fact, Rob Saxon's made this on TV, on the radio today, when he and I were talking about this on Speak Out Loud. He said, you know, that there were all these teachers involved. This is not the case. All the reading I can find, well, he didn't say teachers, he said educators. I'm talking about teachers, see. All the reading I can find talks about a couple of teachers being involved, and no K through three teachers being involved. Think of that. We changed what we teach and how we teach kindergarten through grade three in 45 of our 50 states, 44 actually now. In essence, making huge changes without so much as one trained early childhood educator giving advice or being involved. And we changed the way we educate Portland Public Schools' 48,000 children with an untried, untested, unvetted system of education, the development of which has had none of our teachers, administrators, parents, or students involved in that development. Maybe we should be a little bit more skeptical, just a tad bit more, maybe. And thank you very much for letting me read that. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Steve. Once again, your opinion, I think some of the facts that our staff provided to us are contrary to exactly what you're saying, but there are other parts that I can see where we might be able to find some agreement, and so thank you very much.